Kemp Hannon, Chair of the Health Committee. We are going to do this as a roundtable to have a discussion on some of the white papers that groups have put out. Two of the participants have been grounded. Literally, their airline flights have been grounded. Jeff Smith of the Lewin Group and Jim Nickman of the New York Health Foundation. I actually have Jeff's slides, and if it's appropriate, we have enough time at the end, I may just put some of them up at least, because the Lewin Group has made some interesting points about the design of our pharmaceutical benefit and how savings could be achieved in the current plan. Knowing how hot it is here, we'll try to get the windows open. I'm not so sure what else we can do about it. We are being live broadcast. We have taken the white papers that are referenced in the attendees and put the internet links to those white papers on the health site, the health committee site that's part of the Senate site. It's part of NewYorkSenate.gov, so that they should be accessible to anybody. If anybody also wants to look at the governor's Medicaid redesign site, just go to the governor's page. There's a big link that says modestly Medicaid redesign, and the presentation that was made to the first redesign team meeting last Thursday is there. That has a number of useful statistics, and might give everybody a little bit of an insight as to the direction the Department of Health and the Division of Budget is heading, because many of those statistics were presented by folks in the Division of Budget and the person doing most of the financial work in the Division of Health, Department of Health, John Auber. Let me just start out by introducing our presenters and discussants this morning. Dan Sisto, Healthcare Association of New York State, Haney's. David Rich, Greater New York Hospital Association. Rick Serpent, Independent Healthcare, is going to be discussing our home care programs. Steve Aquario, Association of Counties, not only the county viewpoint, but hope might touch upon the statute passed in the last year about administration of Medicaid by the state. Joined this morning, and as, by the way, everybody's having tremendous problems with the snow and ice, so I know people with the nameplates that indicated they'd be here, and they, I presume, will be joined. Immediately to my right is Senator Bill Larkin, Senator Martin Golden, Senator Greg Ball, Senator Charles Fischillo, and Senator Catherine Young. And just making it time to be introduced, Senator Jim Seward. The question that I would have had was, why, Hannon, would you be having this roundtable in light of the fact that the governor is doing a redesign team? It occurred to me, as the large number of white papers were presented to us as senators, that those white papers and the other ones that have come about since that time represent a very deep amount of thinking about the design of the program, a reaction to the fact that in the last eight budget actions the legislature has taken, there's been net reductions each time to the healthcare systems, that those net reductions are not necessarily aimed at reconfiguring, redesigning, and thinking out how we're going to move forward, and that we need to have this discussion. So the thought was, let's do this Let's do it in public because ultimately we're going to be enacting something in public. Let's do it for both short-term and long-term. And let's see what the wisdom is of the people who actually provide the services can come about. I would imagine that there's been some really terrific white papers that I've seen in just the last few days, maybe spurred on, some already in the works. HCA on home care is also there. I've seen something from the coalition on continuing care. So there's a lot of things that are more developing. And there's a need to look at this in a context that's not budget related. I think we have lost large measures of policy creation by only doing it within the budget. I know in 2008, when we were able to do the budget on time, the health budget on time by April 1, we were then able to use most productively the remaining amount of the legislative session to get policy investigated. I think it may have taken another year or two to get the family health care decision-making bill passed, but the substantive changes to that bill were done because we had the time to do it after the budget passed on time. So I don't know what the forecast is. It certainly is every governor's aim and the legislature's aim to get the budget passed in time, but now our necessity, we have to do this on Medicaid in terms of policy changes. My colleagues, would you like to make a statement to open up? Senator Seward? I will ask the present in the order of Dan Sisto and then David Rich and Rick Serpin and Steve Aquario and 10-15 minutes, and then we'll come back and have some interaction on that.
10-15 each, 10-15 total? 10-15 each?
No, each.
Each, okay. Each. I just didn't know how cryptic I should be.
This is not, we're not doing sound bites.
Okay.
We're trying to get into the different things that the policy considerations that people usually make appointments with us to come and talk about in the office. I'm just thinking it's so necessary in terms of budget gap, we have to do this in public.
Good. Well, thank you, Senator. And to your point about the need for this, I just want to say that I appreciate the legislature and the Senate getting directly engaged like this. I'm privileged to be on the Medicaid reform team, but in the end of the day, a report will come to this legislature, and public policy's been for decades a synthesis of the thought of administration and elected officials from the New York State Legislature. And getting directly involved early on, I think, is absolutely the right thing. There are certainly groups, because of the limitation of the reform group, whose voices need to be heard, whether it's the nursing home associations, the home care association, the medical society, different consumer groups. The legislative process really opens it up, and I think we're going to need that balancing judgment at the end of the day, because another aspect I think emerging is that the Medicaid Reform Task Force, it was stated very clearly that we're not to deal with the number, we're not to deal with the budget number, we're to deal with ideas about reform and proposals on how to restructure health care for Medicaid and health care beyond. But the legislature, like the governor, has to deal with the budget as well. And so again, another imperative for your engagement independent of that activity. I'm pleased you're doing it. Our own recommendations have been submitted, to you, but to expand on them today is a good opportunity. Some of the themes, I think, that you see through them, number one, we tried very hard to make sure that what we proposed was consistent, at least conceptually consistent, with where we think the national healthcare reform movement is taking us. That is to say, if you look closely at it, rather than criticizing for the lack of cost containment, I think there's some of the most substantial cost containment imaginable built into that legislation, but it also recognizes that it's going to take several years to bring about that recreation of the delivery system. So we have accountable care organizations, you have bundling, the linkage of quality and reimbursement, the imperative to engage in clinical integration, basically, an emphasis on prevention and primary care, some of which has already taken place. You have investments in investment in information technology, vast amounts of design and creativity being embedded in the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation, where they're saying, here's $10 billion, be the venture capitalist, go out and figure out what works. There's not a presumption that everybody can do it all tomorrow. If we can, over time, take our Medicaid program and align it in those kind of directions with a greater dependency on the coordination of care, prevention, and primary care, but the coordination of care all through the spectrum of healthcare delivery, then we're not going to end up in a situation I've seen so many times in my 25 years at Haney's where the country's going in this direction, New York thinks it has something better off to do, it goes in a different way. So we've tried to not only come up with suggestions that we think make sense for New York, but also to allow us then to position it so that not we're duplicating everything. We don't need, you know, two different ways to do accountable care, two different ways to do bundling, two different ways to link quality, two different survey systems, two different oversight agencies. There has to be a New York twist to things. I accept that. You always want to make sure that what's being done is pertinent to your state. But in terms of general direction, it's time for us, you know, to try and administratively streamline what we do here by aligning it with what the rest of the country is doing. So that's one of the basic assumptions going in. Another one is with respect to just the bias, I suppose, with respect to Medicaid itself and how important it is to have more than one forum. I have found over the years a tendency to mix up the word expenditures and the word costs and rates as though they were all the same thing, and to compare one state to another as though, like Medicare, it was a standard system across the country. The reality is that Medicaid in every state is significantly different than the next state, and that the comparisons, unless you really sit down and quantify the distinctions, tend to be false, erroneous, misleading. And I'll give you a couple of quick examples. We hear all the time, and I'm from a healthcare association, but knowing hospitals best, that hospital expenditures are going up. But it was interesting, and to the department's credit, a lot of very incisive charts, as you noted the other day, were presented about Medicaid. One of them showed Medicaid inpatient actually gone down 7% over, I think it was five, six years. What's interesting is at other times, we just talk about, costs going up. So my metaphor would be, if you had a child in college and you paid $30,000 a year, and the next year you had two children in college and you paid $60,000 a year, your costs of college did not go up. Your expenditures went up. In New York, our expenditures go up while we continue to cut rates and cut rates and cut rates, and all the time claiming that costs have gone up. So as we go forward, I think it'd be very healthy to try and make sure all of the agencies, all of the advocates, and certainly the legislature and the administration distinguish when they mean costs, when they mean rates, and when they mean expenditures, because it leads to some of this misperception about New York versus others. New York, in fact, is higher in its expenditures than most of the rest of the country. We also have, according to the Kaiser Foundation, about 26% of New York State's population on Medicaid. The average in the rest of the country is somewhere between 18 and 19%. So we start off, when you say, well, how can you make up that gap? Well, we start off, therefore, with 37% more than the average on Medicaid than other places. We don't bother to adjust those kind of statistics for where the patients live based on the cost of living. So if a heavy concentration is in New York or Long Island and Westchester, that all gets washed out. We don't bother to consider that New York's population is aging more rapidly than the nation as a whole, and so the intensity of services due to that population gets washed out. And of course, we never mention that over a period of over 15 years, New York has taken every opportunity it can to take in every one of its existing Treasury expenditures and convert it into Medicaid, where it in fact made money for the state and in fact was not neither an expenditure nor a cost, but a revenue raiser. So for example, we'll tax nursing homes up the gazoo, turn around, raise their rates to cover the cost of the tax, Medicaid the whole thing, bring down money from Washington to pay for half of it, and then claim Medicaid expenditures to nursing homes went up when in fact it was a revenue raiser for them. add intergovernmental transfers, add taking public health and mental health programs over the years and medicating them. I don't know whether the number's now 8 billion or 9 billion of the 52, but it certainly isn't a cost. It certainly is just an expenditure when being paid by Washington. Those are the kind of distinctions that I think are very important to keep in mind, or let's stop comparing us to other states. but understand that none of what I've just said negates the need to redesign the Medicaid program. It doesn't negate the need to restructure it or to do it in a way that not only improves the care delivery for Medicaid patients, but for everybody. And in fact, if we're trying to do things consistent with Washington, that's what we're going to end up, fortunately, I hope, accomplishing at the end of the day. With respect to some specific examples of where what I mean about restructuring the system, I think I have heard at the Medicaid reform meetings, looking at other people's testimony, work by United Hospital Fund, the Commonwealth, Kaiser, this administration, there are so many similar themes. I think that, you know, we have all gotten to the point, as the governor had said about 2 weeks ago, where the easy activity has been done. And the good news is that we have nothing left but hard choices. We can either continue the path, which we've proven doesn't work, of just slashing rates and expanding our promises, which every 3 months has put us back at a budget table debating again, or we can actually try and figure out how to redesign the healthcare system. The difficulty with choosing the latter is best summed up, I thought, when I read over the weekend a study by, not a study, but a report by MedPAC to the Congress. And they're talking about coordinating the care of dual eligible beneficiaries, one that I think is now on the lips of just about everybody, you know, who's talking about what we can do in New York State. I thought it's a great read. It's about 40 pages, and I didn't know enough about dual eligibles till I read it. But it talks about how there's a fact. I read a report by United Hospital Fund from, I think it was 2008. It sounds like MedPAC plagiarized the United Hospital Fund's report, because they start out talking about the distinctions in the population under those who are dual eligible. And so there are some, I forgot the percentage, but high teens, who actually are Medicare and Medicaid eligible, but they don't even need care. They're healthy. So let's not spend a lot of money worrying about that group. There's another group that are institutionalized dual eligibles and another one that are community-based dual eligibles. And there's different approaches to take for each group. But yeah, the underlying...
A dual eligible being?
Someone who is both Medicare and Medicaid eligible. And of course, the states and the government fight about who's going to pay for them. So we got all these different dynamics about how to shift costs between the governments. But in effect, the basic rules are done, and everybody would agree if we could figure out how to share the savings between the federal government and the state government and the people who provide and oversee or ensure the care, that would probably be the best thing, because the underlying theme about everything we've crafted is that this health system is dysfunctional predominantly because it's been silo-based, and it's been silo-based because that's what the incentives required it to be, and continue to drive, with some exceptions, volume over the provision of care over time, space, setting, and so forth. So. What was instructive, however, and maybe it played into the, there was a lot that was instructive, but one of the cautions in it on page 152, where they talk about integrating care, is they take a step back. It's only a few sentences, given it's MedPAC, but they take a step back and they say, and by the way, the transformation of healthcare delivery requires investment, because you have to bring together providers in a new fashion, you have to link them in ways they've not been done before, you have to invest massively in information technology, you have to create a new emphasis on primary and preventive care when it wasn't there. And of course, aggregating the providers is a lot easier than disaggregating the money at the end of the day. So unless you've actually brought them together in a single entity, which, you know, around the country we have a lot more of that, but we have some in New York, unless you've done that, then you need a fair and reasonable way to make everybody truly a partner in the endeavor, or they'll turn on each other. And so what we see today early on is, as providers look at this, you know, the physicians look at it, the community health centers, the hospitals, whoever, they say, oh, This is good as long as I get the bundle of money to take care of the patient, right? And I'll farm it out to everybody else. That's not the mindset that's going to work. I believe we really need either you have large continuums of care systems that can take on this kind of responsibility, or you have real partnerships across the groups that were siloed. But the financial incentives have to be changed so that everything's aligned, and that goes for state and federal as well. So what they say in the document is, look, over time, this is going to save significant sums of money, not just for dual eligibles, but for high-cost populations. And for dual eligibles, you can get waivers, state plan amendments. You can do it in a way that shares the savings, like I mentioned. You could do it in a way that gives this entity the entire risk. Or you could just give them a fee to coordinate the care where it hasn't been coordinated before. So they talk about same as United Hospital Fund. Lots of different approaches, but this happens over time, and it requires initial investment. So the difficulty is, to me, with not just, I'm using this as an example of a theme of, again, that occurs, whether it's mental health or primary care. This stuff just takes a little time. And the dilemma is that, as we heard from the reform team, we've got a balanced budget this year. We're going to give you X dollars in the budget number that you have to achieve. You can try and fill it up with alternatives to whatever we provide. But if you don't meet the target, then chances are our cuts are going to go in place. And you've seen those in the past and you don't like them, so think hard, right? It wouldn't take a lot to induce me to think hard about this stuff anyway, because anybody who's a professional knows the system hasn't worked well in a long, long time. On the other hand, we also know, and from our own experience as a state with HEAL and F-sharp and watching places like Montefiore, which has been one of the early leaders in trying to provide a risk assumption, PHSPs and others, that yes, it does require massive investment. And after seven, eight budget fights in 2.5 years, there's not a whole lot of capital in most places left for investment. So we may have a tension between how do we come up with a magic number, especially if we're going to take all revenue raising off the table, how are we going to come up with a magic number and fill it with good ideas, and to the extent we're short, you know, decimate the system again, or change our promises, which is even sometimes more difficult in a political process, versus invest longer term. In Wisconsin, for example, where we've heard about, you know, the great techniques that were used to generate ideas, they at least take a 2-year budget approach. You know, we have a problem, and we don't have the ability to think beyond 1 year here, I gather. As it was said the other day, we have two committees that work in the reform meeting at the same time. We're trying to reform the health system, but we're trying to come up with a number. So the good news is we were told it wasn't our responsibility to deal with the number, just the ideas. So I'll go back to the ideas. Throughout our set of recommendations then, which begins with talking about care coordination and would apply as well to behavioral health, we have programs in place, demos, projects, initiatives that we've never really blown open in New York that we know are consistent with all those directions I talked about. The New York Care Coordination Program, the Managed Addiction Treatment Program, New York City's Primary Care and Mental Health Program. We have managed care plans, PHSPs, and I think if we go at it incrementally, where we start off maybe with just paying for the coordination, except for places who can go a little further and accept, say, a bundle payment for some directed, targeted population, or maybe even beyond that for some of the bigger systems, if in fact they can take on the risk, like a managed care plan would do, and we target the populations where there's potentially the most to save, then over a period of time, and some of it right away, we could probably do some significant savings. And that would certainly include expanding the use of the medical homes, such as we've seen work relatively well so far up in the Adirondacks, and one or two other medical home models in place. We have the ability to do health homes now in New York, largely based on community-based care. that can be expanded. Consistent with this kind of transformation, I think we also, I would hope that there would also be an effort to genuinely reduce malpractice cost, regulatory costs, by streamlining a lot of the regulatory apparatus. I talk about, you know, legislature and governors needing to balance their promises with their ability to pay. In the case of the bureaucracy, frankly, I think it's a matter of balancing one's appetite to control and oversee and regulate with what with the capacity of the staff. We've seen tremendous shrinkage in state government. I think a lot of what providers are going to be asked to do is going to require a lot of flexibility and innovation, and we simply can't be bogged down in 2 and 3 year processes to get certificate of needs accomplished, for example. And even though there's many administrative improvements that have been made, put things in an administrative category, now it takes a long time to get things done even administratively. Again, we can't seem to get away from multiple survey processes, and all of the kind of regulation that made so much sense in the 70s, 80s, and 90s really has to give way to flexibility to streamline the system and save the providers' costs for the cuts that have been on the table and presumably still are. And of course, malpractice reform is one that this should be the year where it's taken seriously. If everybody has to give something, if there has to be a shared sacrifice, then I think the shared sacrifice for the trial bar this year is that they don't gain anything, but that some malpractice reform is allowed to progress. So those are the over. That's, you know, I guess my 15 minutes of fame are up, but that's basically the conceptual approach we're taking. Some of the highlights, and of course, you can talk about generic drugs and pharmacy and finding ways to get a more personal accountability, both for paying for care and keeping oneself healthy. You know, spousal refusal, and there's a lot of other areas beyond delivery system redesign that's in our report. So I'll stop for questions or whatever.
Well, let's just let everybody do a basic presentation, and then you've raised as many questions as you said. So, but I need to be fair to everybody. David.
Great, thank you, Senator. And first of all, thank you so much for having this roundtable today. We were not surprised at all that, notwithstanding that there's a Medicaid redesign team, you wanted to do this as well, because one thing we've always valued about your leadership of this committee is you try to get things right, which is going to be so important given the size of the budget deficit and the margin for error that there will be in trying to save as much money as the state is going to try to save in this coming budget. So thank you very much for having this this roundtable today. We're greatly encouraged by you having this roundtable and also Governor Cuomo's approach in empaneling the Medicaid redesign team to try and find the best ideas from across the state to look to the best and the brightest to come up with substitutes to some of the same old types of budget proposals that we've seen in the past. And when I say the best and brightest, I'm not really referring so much to the team itself, although we're honored to be a part of the team and flatter ourselves that we're bright, but the fact that they are holding the hearings that they're holding one tomorrow in Buffalo and then the following day in Rochester, and they'll have them all throughout the state, that you can actually put anyone in the entire state can put forward their proposals through the website, I think is important as well. And we do need alternatives to the usual types of cuts that we've seen before, and that's why I think we're excited about the Medicaid redesign team charge. We can't continue the traditional approach that we've had. Since April of 07, we've seen providers cut or taxed 9 times. This year, hospitals in the state will receive $1.2 billion less than they would have if we hadn't have had those 9 rounds of cuts and taxes. Just to put that into perspective, the Medicaid redesign team presentation that the Department of Health gave last week estimates that hospital Medicaid spending will be about $12.6 billion in the coming year. That was actual hospitals and clinics. So the $1.2 billion that hospitals won't receive this year is about 10% of total Medicaid spending projected on hospitals In the coming fiscal year. So that's a very large amount of money to already have been taken out of the system before we even start talking about the reductions that will need to be made to close the $10 billion budget gap. So I think people don't really realize, because we've had all of these separate budget actions that have taken place, as Dan said, sometimes 3 months apart over the last few years, that when you look at it all together, you actually are looking at a 10% reduction in revenue for hospitals that has already happened. And unfortunately, we'll probably see even more. The cuts that we've seen and the tax increases that we've seen are particularly challenging for safety net hospitals, those whose main source of revenue is the Medicaid program, because they serve such a disproportionate share of Medicaid populations, because of the communities that they serve. They are the provider system that the state relies upon to take care of the Medicaid population that the state is responsible for, whether they're public hospitals or voluntary hospitals that serve high percentages of Medicaid patients. They are the ones who really have suffered most by these multiple rounds of budget cuts over the last few years. They are the providers that provide the vast majority, not just of inpatient care, but also ambulatory care for the Medicaid population through their outpatient clinics. And also, the state relies on those providers for providing a huge number of the deliveries in the state. Many people don't realize that Medicaid actually covers 50% of all of the deliveries, the obstetrical deliveries in the entire state, 60% in New York City, over 70% in Brooklyn and in the Bronx. And so without the Medicaid provider system, we'd have a major problem with obstetrical care in the state. So Medicaid cuts, you know, often people talk about let's have across-the-board Medicaid cuts, but I think we need to remember that there really is no such thing as an across-the-board Medicaid cut, because if one hospital has 60% of their budget is Medicaid, and one has 5% of their budget is Medicaid, then the Medicaid cut obviously affects the safety net 60% provider much more than it does the other. So we need to be very conscious as we move forward about what the impact of budget proposals will be on access for the Medicaid population and for the others served by those safety net providers in their communities. Before I get into some of the nitty-gritty of our reform proposals, you know, we don't really have any illusions at this point in time that the Medicaid redesign team will be able to come up with 100% substitution for cuts. We hope they can. We certainly are going to try very hard to do that. And we're a part of the team, as I mentioned, and everyone in this room hopefully will be submitting all of their ideas. But to come up with ideas that will save a lot starting on April 1st are going to be difficult. And so following up on something that Dan said, I think we really need to ask the legislature and really try and insist that this year they really enact some proposals that will help Medicaid providers reduce their costs. One of them that Dan mentioned, which is so important and is so important to the obstetrical care in this that is provided in this state, would be finally doing something about medical malpractice reform. So I totally identify myself with what Dan said about the need for that and the need for shared sacrifice across the board, as well as the need to look at regulations and not having new mandates on hospitals. A lot of what Dan and I and others who have put forward reform papers are talking about is actually having hospitals take on a lot more responsibility than they've had before for managing populations. In federal healthcare reform and also here in the state, people are talking about hospitals owning more the full care of the patients that they serve, not just looking at what happens while they're in the four walls of the hospital, but also looking at what happens 30 days after they leave and shortly before they come, and helping to manage their care and coordinate their care. Given that, we need to not be passing, you know, one-off bills throughout the session that put new mandates on hospitals, and we need to be looking at the mandates that are already on them so that we can reduce their costs so that they can take on some more of these responsibilities. One other thing that is essential to all of the reform issues that I will discuss in a moment is HIT. And as you know, the federal government, through the economic stimulus that was passed a few years ago did provide money for providers for health information technology. Some of that is through the Medicaid program. Some states have already been availing themselves of the Medicaid economic stimulus money for health information technology, but our state has not yet. I know there's a good faith effort to do that. I know the Department of Health is working on that, but we really need to make sure and stay on top of that, because if we are able to enact some of the reforms that we'll be talking about as part of this budget, having the health information technology in place that can actually help providers monitor care outside of the hospital setting, follow up outside of the hospital setting, and understand which different providers are providing care for the Medicaid population, the health information technology is really important to that. So we need to understand why some states have been able to avail themselves of the money already and why we are not quite there yet. Having said that, I'd like to go into a few of the specific ideas that we have put forward, both in a paper that we came out with at the end of the summer, but also in a revised version that we submitted to the Medicaid redesign team last week. First of all, a lot of our recommendations look at what the state has identified to be quote-unquote high-cost populations, populations with many different medical needs. At the Medicaid redesign team meeting last week here in Albany, the state had a slide that showed that about 75% of all Medicaid spending is spent on 20% of the enrollees, 75-20. And they also said that about half of all Medicaid spending in the state is on about 800,000 individuals who have multiple chronic conditions. Those may include health conditions, but may also include mental health, substance abuse, et cetera. So there's a huge amount of the Medicaid spending on a very concentrated group of, you know, smaller group of people. There, as was mentioned before, there are about now 5 million Medicaid beneficiaries, but about 800,000 who have multiple chronic illnesses take up about half of the spending. As it would obviously be understood that people with chronic illnesses cost more, but what we haven't done well in the state yet is try and coordinate their care. For many of the populations with chronic illnesses, even if they are in Medicaid managed care plans, as some of them are, we haven't really coordinated their care very well. What we have learned from some of the demonstrations that Dan mentioned before that are happening at places like Montefiore and New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation and others is that the Medicaid population with a lot of these multiple chronic illnesses don't necessarily lend themselves well to the traditional just managed care model, where someone will be at an insurance office and make a phone call to the beneficiary and just say, you know, we want to make sure you followed up with your meds. It really takes much more of a hands-on approach. And so what we have been working on with Haney's and also been talking to the health department about is to try and make sure that many different providers across the state, but particularly those providers that are already providing services to the chronically ill Medicaid population, can create integrated care coordination teams that are responsible for providing or coordinating all of their enrollees' health services and connecting them with social services. These teams typically are made up of nurses, social workers, and outreach workers. They can actually go into the community and follow up with the patients after they leave a hospital or after they leave an FQHC or leave a diagnostic and treatment center. They can talk to them about how to make sure they do get the medicines that they need, because if they get the medicines that they need, they might not have to come back to the hospital and then incur another Medicaid cost for another hospital inpatient visit. Or they may be able to have their care managed by a much lower cost healthcare provider outside of the hospital rather than having to come back to the hospital again and be admitted. So if these teams could be put into place, they wouldn't have to be put into place everywhere. The State Department of Health is helping to identify where these 800,000 individuals are getting their care now It's not every hospital in the state or every FQHC in the state or every diagnostic and treatment center, but they really are, there's a lot of concentration in different areas of the state and of New York City where these teams could be put into place and much better coordinate care, cut down on duplication, cut down on unnecessary use of care, and really provide a better care experience for these higher cost individuals. The Health Reform Act at the federal level, the Affordable Care Act, provides a 90% Medicaid match for 2 years for services provided by these types of teams taking care of the chronically ill. They also, by the way, provide that 90% match, we think, for some spending the state is already doing, but only getting a 50% match on, including managed long-term care plan premiums and some other spending. And so we could actually identify some more federal funding for some things we're doing already, which could help pay for the 10% state obligation that there would be for reimbursing these teams. So that's one of the things that we think makes a lot of sense. It would take some time to implement, but we, and I know Haney's also is committed to, if we do enact this kind of proposal within the budget, committed to working with our members who are identified by the state as the ones who really are caring the most for these populations now to help them get up and running with these types of teams as soon as possible. Second, another high-cost population is the mental health population. Many people don't know that the SSI population that are in managed care, for that population, mental health is actually carved out of the benefit and is provided in an unmanaged fee-for-service system. So most of the healthcare needs for the SSI population is provided through a managed care plan. Many of them are hospital managed care plans. But when it comes to mental health services, those are carved out and those are provided separately on a fee-for-service basis. The Office of Mental Health has said that they are considering, rather than having that in a sort of unmanaged fee-for-service situation as it currently is, contracting with a single statewide behavioral health organization to manage that the mental health benefit for the SSI population. However, the plans that are currently serving the population for their health care needs as opposed to their mental health needs really want to have a role in the management of that care, and we would agree that it doesn't make a whole lot of sense, and actually we would say it doesn't really make any sense to have a situation where you have the health care needs and the mental health care needs so bifurcated. And so there may be a way of sort of compromising and saying, why don't we say that each Medicaid managed care plan needs to contract with a behavioral health organization so that the Medicaid managed care plan is still involved in the management of the care, but they are working with an organization that is expert in mental health care management. That could also be done probably fairly quickly by just requiring the plans to do such contracting. So that's one of the things that we have put forward. And clearly, the mental health is one that is very costly in the state and does need some care coordination. When it comes to long-term care, I know that the gentleman to my left will be speaking much more about home health care, but one of the high-cost populations is certainly those who are in need of long-term care services. We have a very seemingly uncoordinated long-term care program within New York State. There are five different categories, from nursing home, personal care, certified home health agency, long-term home health care, managed long-term care. But there doesn't really seem to be a clear rationale as to why a New York State resident chooses one over another or is steered towards one over another. And so what we need, and I think many different organizations within the state have called for, a uniform assessment tool to better help decide what is the best level of care for different populations. I think we need more care coordination for the higher cost long-term care populations as well. And then also, there may be some challenges at looking at eligibility reforms because of the Federal Affordable Care Act, which seems to say states can't make a lot of Medicaid eligibility changes over the next few years. But there are issues that we should at least look at and I think understand if something can be done about when it comes to eligibility for long-term care. For instance, there is no asset transfer look back at all on home care. So you can be very wealthy, transfer all your assets one day, and have Medicaid pay for your home health care needs the following. And that, now, while part of the point of that was to encourage home care over more costly nursing home care, it does seem like there should be something in between the two. And there might be, and by everyone putting their heads together, maybe there's something that can be looked at there. Dan mentioned the dual eligible population, meaning those who are eligible for both Medicare and Medicaid. This has perennially been a difficult one to solve because the federal government pays for some benefits through Medicare and the state pays for others through Medicaid. We do know that there's a lot of inappropriate bouncing back and forth of nursing home patients from nursing homes to hospitals and back again. And it's always been difficult for the state to put into effect a program where you could try and help manage the health care needs of the individual in the nursing home rather than have them go back to the hospital, partly because when they go to the hospital, the Medicare program picks up the cost again. So they go from the Medicaid program paying the cost in the nursing home, and then when they go to the hospital, the Medicare program picks up the cost. If you could put into effect programs where you had nurse practitioners or nurses within a nursing home to help manage the care better and provide health care services in the nursing home, you'd have a much better quality of care for those patients rather than sending them back to the hospital where they will be for several days and then sending them back to the nursing home again. And if you could have the state work with the federal government to allow the state to share in some of the Medicare savings that accrue from that type of program, then you could actually provide better management of care, cut down on hospital utilization for this high-cost population. And so we really do think that there might be some opportunities of looking at that, looking at some real ways with the federal government of sharing in those types of savings. I have some other ideas as well. My 15 minutes is probably up at this point. Just the one last thing I'd like to say, though, is that I really think it's very important that even beyond Medicaid, that we make sure that when we enact this year's budget and look at what the Medicaid redesign team is looking at and others are looking at, that we look at the impact on the healthcare system as a whole. And I say that because there are many providers, as I mentioned before, who are essential, who are in inner city areas or are public county facilities or maybe New York City public hospitals, who provide so much care to the Medicaid population that we really will see with another round of Medicaid cuts some closures, some major layoffs, reductions of services. We've seen closures happen in the last few years. A lot of you have had closures within your districts and near your districts. And it's always sort of after the fact people try and figure out, oh no, what are we going to do now? We've lost a hospital. Now, I'm not at all saying that every hospital is essential, and I'm not saying that we need to make sure that every hospital stays open. But I do think that it's incumbent upon the legislature to understand from the administration when they come out with their budget this year, and even when hopefully we substitute some redesign ideas for the budget cuts, what will the real impact be? We usually get the numbers from Haney's and from Greater New York and from the Department of Health about what the dollar amount of the cut is, but that doesn't necessarily tell you that a $10 million cut to one hospital will actually mean they close and the community will no longer see them anymore, whereas another hospital, a $10 million cut doesn't necessarily mean that. So I think trying to before you get to the situation where a hospital is actually closed 6 months from now or 8 months from now or 10 months from now, and everyone's trying to figure out what to do about that, we need to go in with our eyes open and perhaps have some different strategies when it comes to cuts for some of the institutions that really could be very vulnerable and on the bubble. so that we don't run into a major major public health problem down the road.
Thank you, David. Appreciate it. Rick Serpin, Rick, just tell everybody what independent care systems are, because it's not self-evident, as everybody else has done.
No, I understand. Well, first, thank you, Senator, and the committee for inviting me. And independent care system is a managed long-term care plan for people with physical disabilities located in New York City. It's affiliated with two other organizations. PHI is a national research and policy research and advocacy organization for home care aides and nurses aides throughout the country. And Cooperative Home Care, which is actually the first of the organizations to start, is a worker-owned licensed home care agency, which is well known nationally for its quality jobs, quality care model. And I'm sitting here not as representing a trade association like my colleagues at the table, but because I decided to write a paper in June, actually, because I've sat in many policy discussions as an officer of the State Home Care Association, as an advisor to the United Hospital Fund. We've had many internal PHI discussions and at national meetings. And what usually happens in those meetings is that we get to a level of honesty about what we each do and what happens in the real world. And then we get to the policy discussions and the papers that get written that, in my terms, are at a level of sight that ignore some of the underlying issues. And that if there is ever a time in New York State to write an honest report, I felt like this was the time to do it. It's not because I think I'm brighter than anybody else, it's simply because I might be crazier than anybody else to take the shots related to what's written here. And I also have to say that over the last 2 years, we had to cut 12% of our costs in our program at ICS. We had to do that, and in keeping with what Dan said, we had to make a decision to invest in care management software at the same time as we were laying off staff. And it seemed like to a lot of people in the organization like that was a really crazy decision. We cut utilization rates in several key areas, and we did so, I think, without harming anybody. And we didn't have disenrollments related to those cuts as one indicator that was true. But it really made me clear that you could cut and cut and cut, and you could cut very simply and act like there's no effect, and you will not come out with the same program. Or you can think about what is most important to you and what do you control, and focus on that, and then go from there. And I think that is what redesign is about, as the governor and this committee have described. I have my own personal experience with that. It was very, very hard to do the things we did, but I feel like the integrity of our agency and our program is still intact, even though we have cut a great deal of money from our agency. So that leaves me with, I think there are three underlying issues in our report that are not as perhaps as clearly stated as they should have been. One is that we believe that we have to focus on what we do control, and that is Medicaid. We can hope that Medicare will link up with us in certain ways, but there is no telling that that will happen. That has been talked about for years. The environment for doing that was probably a lot better before the midterm elections. There are still people in CMS who very much want to do that and are saying we will do that. But the political environment is much more tenuous than it was before. Within Medicaid, I believe the nursing home eligible population is the most complex and costly population related to home care services. And I am only focusing on home care and its eventual linkage to primary care and acute care. So the Medicaid only, so we serve a population that is 50% Medicaid only and 50% duly eligible. That population, you cannot tell them apart by any demographic or clinical characteristic other than they are nursing home eligible. Their form of payment for their services makes no difference. And I talked to other agencies around the country that have similar populations where there's a high number of Medicaid only, and that's their experience as well. So I think that as much as I absolutely believe that it's important to integrate with Medicare and to integrate long-term care and acute and primary care, I don't think we can forget that it is a Medicaid nursing home eligible population that is the most complex and costly, and there are at least three distinct subgroups in that: the elderly, the physically disabled, and the developmentally disabled. And when we say, when we focus only on duly eligible, we end up focusing on the elderly. And we do that because many younger people who are receiving Medicaid long-term care services do not have an employment history and are therefore not eligible for Medicare.
It's also because the only one duly eligible, you have to be over 65 to be eligible.
Right. Although there are younger people who become eligible for Medicare, but only if they have a two-year employment history. Right. The second thing that I would say is that the paper is based entirely on when you have limited resources, you have to focus on where you want to be, where you want to put them. And so the, one of the things that the paper clearly says is we actually need to raise the bar for eligibility for nursing home eligibility. Something that I personally would wish we didn't have to do, but I believe it's absolutely important to provide, continue to provide good with an environment where there is less resources to make sure that the people who are in the programs are getting proper resources. And that we need to not only direct attention and resources, we need to figure out what the right mix of skills and services and program models and outcome measures are for different populations. And the three populations that I mentioned, even within that, the elderly person with dementia is different from a more frail elderly person without dementia. The person with multiple sclerosis and spinal cord injury is different from a person with other disabilities. So that it's a complex and diverse population. It's not simple. And so that we really need to figure out what works for what kind of people. And the third thing is that I believe that New York State, partly because of the efforts of this health committee, has one of the, if not the most advanced, home and community-based service systems in the country. I think it actually shares it with Wisconsin as real leaders, and that as we talk about redesign, we really need to focus on how to build on the distinct strengths of the system and reduce or eliminate the weaknesses and not just cut out whole programs. Because I do believe that in some of the programs that are talked about today, there are some tremendous strengths. So going to the paper very quickly, hopefully, is that the first thing it talks about reducing and containing Medicaid costs, and as Senator Hannon said, we don't want to just focus on costs, but at the end of the day, there has to be a way that we can see for reducing costs. One is, as I said, is to raise the eligibility threshold, reduce the number of eligible participants by requiring a nursing home level of care, use a common assessment tool, and set that bar at a reasonably level that, and you will ask, what's that reasonable level? And so I would argue that it's the equivalent of at least 15 and possibly 20 hours of personal care a week, that people receiving less than that are not nursing, should not be considered nursing home eligible. The second area where cuts could happen is reducing home care service utilization where it's appropriate. And we often talk about that as in the 12 and 24 hour care. I do not think that's where it's appropriate, although you might be able to get people moving from 24 to live in and 12, therefore 12 hours. Where our experience is that to focus on the mid-range services, the people who are getting 10 hours going to 8, the people getting 8 hours going to 6, and not all the time that could happen, but the important thing is that's the place to look. And what you'll hear me say is that you need organizational structures that can focus on it in that way. The next thing is simply care management is a really valuable resource. It's about using interdisciplinary skills and processes to integrate health and social services, and it does not need to be used for everybody. The person who just needs personal care does not need care management, and the person who is more complex does. And we can talk about, in the paper it describes what definitions of complexity are. If you were to look at the Wisconsin Family Care Program, you would see a very similar set of requirements. So the point there is, I won't go through that today, but you can figure out what complexity is versus non-complex. And the other thing that I think is really important is that care management is most important for critical transitions, not only in hospital and nursing home entrance or discharge, but when you have a potential loss of housing, when you've lost the caregiver or a family member who was really important in the caregiving process, when the home care aide, for whatever reason, that was providing care for you for the last 4 years, all of a sudden has to move or no longer can provide that care. when if you're wheelchair dependent, when your wheelchair breaks down and no one is able to give you a good answer when and how it'll get fixed or replaced. And of course, what everybody has come to recognize, and both of you have talked about before, is the interplay of behavioral health issues and or substance abuse in the care management process. I could regale you with stories, but you can rest assured that I won't. There are basically three major programs, and everybody knows these programs, that provide care for chronically ill and disabled people in the city. I'm excluding the Certified Home Health Agency, which does that a lot today. In the paper, it argues for restricting the certified agency to acute care and not allowing it to provide care on a long-term basis. We have read a lot about the New York City Personal Care Program, although personal care exists throughout the state. It is a much maligned program. I think that much of the criticism is actually unfair and unwarranted, and that's not a popular statement. But if one was to look at even the court case, one would have to say that it's unfounded in the sense that the city does not gain one way or the other whether people get home care or nursing home care. You would have to look at it and say that roughly 40 to 50% of the beneficiaries in the personal care program are more complex than sit in the typical managed long-term care plan or long-term home health care program. They're not the same people. 40 to 50% of them are not the same people. There's a consumer-directed personal assistance service option in the city's personal care program that does not exist in most places. Actually, ICS is the only managed long-term care plan that has a consumer-directed option. It is also a good employer. It pays $10 an hour because of the living wage requirement. It's the only program that does that. Home health aides and other programs are averaging $8 to $8.50 an hour. No one gets rich or even middle class by getting even $10 an hour. But that's a big difference in one's wages and annual income. And finally, what was missed in the court filing is that the personal care program is the provider of last resort. In terms of the safety net that David were describing, there is no one, if the personal care program isn't able to handle that today, they have no place to go with finding a provider to provide that care. And in many of the kinds of cases that were cited in the court case, I believe that they were probably either fair hearings that changed it, or that HRA simply had no place to go.
That's the court case that was filed last week against the city of New York by the federal government.
Yes. So the long-term home health care program, broad range of services, personal care represents 60 to 70% of those costs. It has an individual budget cap. It precludes the most complex people because of that budget cap. And it's very stable. Although it actually has around 14,000 people today compared to the 45,000, which is also stable in personal care. Managed long-term care looks very much like long-term home health care program, with the exception of a few other services like nursing homes included in the cap. And it's growing. It has 26,000 people today. It's only 10 years old. Long-term home health care program is 25 years old. It also is a very flexible program in what it's able to do. The paper basically argues for a restructuring and a consolidation of keeping the personal care program, moving the most complex people in personal care into a restructured care management organization that consolidates the managed long-term care program and the long-term home health care program. And the one major place that's an investment in the way that Dan was talking about is we believe that it's very important for home health aides and personal care aides to have the same level of wages at $10 an hour. Again, we are not asking even to be at parity with nursing home aides who make $15 an hour, $15.50 an hour, but to make the same $10 an hour that personal care aides do. It is to redesign the system and act like that isn't a problem would be tragic in the lives of many of those people. And the last two things, I'm not going to talk about this, the restructured care management organization program, simply because of time. It does essentially take the best features of the long-term home health care program and the managed long-term care plan. It allows for sufficient transition time to do it, and it sets up financial reserve requirements, which I think are doable for almost every long-term healthcare program. But it, for sake of time, it will not do that. I think the last thing I want to say is that our home and community-based service system is essentially focused on supporting people to live independently. We are not focused on avoiding potential medical complications. There are some agencies that do that and are proud of doing that, and it's not to say that there are agencies, including my own, that do it. However, the system as a whole is not structured to do that, and it is very important to do it. And the health homes proposals that both of you have talked about, it provides a vehicle for connecting what happens on the home care side with primary care. It's a really important bridge that we think should be created between the two, and is a major form of integrating the two. When you combine it with shared hospital savings on the Medicare side, it gets you to a real form of integration without combining everything in the world and waiting for the world to change dramatically. And the last thing is that I believe at one level, any one of us can make things sound totally logical and why don't we do this tomorrow? There are very good reasons. The long-term health care program is a major source of revenue for many nursing homes. That revenue has to get replaced. This is not meant to destroy one program and make one program really good and hurt the long-term care sector on the nursing home side. What should happen, though, I believe is very important to happen, is that home care should be recognized for what it should be paying for and what it actually pays for in the home, and the nursing home sector should be adequately compensated for what it is in its own facilities. And looking at the world in that way, unfortunately, when we're all sitting in provider associations, as I once did, and this is not meant to say anything about what the associations are, we have to say that what each of us does is really important and should stay the same way. I hope in the process of redesign, we protect those things that need to be protected and also build some things in new that are going to require some investment and put us in a much different, in a transformative place than we stand to. I'm finished. Thank you.
Now you can take a breath. Mr. Aquario.
Thank you, Senator.
You don't have to explain it to us counties.
Well, in New York, we have 57 of them. We have five boroughs in the city for a total of 62. It's a diverse state, as you know, Senator, from where you come from in Nassau County to areas in western New York and in central New York who have drastically different governmental structures. The Board of Supervisors form of government, county government, and Senator Seward's district is drastically different than a county executive form of government in Nassau County. Orange County, where Senator Larkin comes from. But over these past few decades, if you will, we have evolved into a state that has an enormous burden on property taxpayers financing Medicaid. And on behalf of those property taxpayers, I want to thank you, Senator Hannon, for reaching out to us and including a representative of property taxpayers in this discussion, in this debate, and this important program called Medicaid. Over the past year, we have identified 9 state-mandated programs that consume 90% of a county's property tax. In some instances, these mandates consume greater than 90% of the property tax, up to 130% of local taxation for just these 9 programs, the largest of which is Medicaid. So it is important that you included the representation of counties, and we thank you for that. Essentially, there's a short-term goal of county governments, and that is to eliminate the trend factor of the Medicaid cap. It's currently growing at 3% every year. The cap imposed in 2005 has saved property taxpayers billions of dollars since its inception, but a short-term goal is to have a hard cap on local taxation, especially in the redesign of Medicaid. Another short-term goal is to enhance and improve the integrity of the Medicaid program through county-state efforts in fraud, waste, and abuse. We think we can do and should do a better job of policing the system, preventing errors before they occur. The current system is not structured well. It needs to have
major improvement in it. We are a unit of government closest to the providers. We work well with the providers. There are often mistakes are made that are simply mistakes and errors and are not fraudulent. But we have a governmental structure that is engaged in this effort, and in certain parts of the state can provide an important function. A long-term goal for counties across the state is the phase-out and the redesign of Medicaid consistent with national health reform. We believe the nearly $8 billion of the $54 billion or so through local taxation can and should be phased out consistent with national health reform and the implementation of health insurance exchanges. But one of the reasons you invited us here today was to talk about administering Medicaid in the state. So let me take a few minutes and talk about the administration of the state Medicaid program, and then conclude with a few observations or comments we made as part of the Medicaid redesign team, issues to provoke discussion. This is a complex subject area. This is a very difficult thing to get your arms around, whether or not you're a hospital organization or nursing home organization, a home health care provider. Counties are largely payers, but we engage in the providing of services in long-term care and certain home health programs and mental health programs. And so we are also a provider, if you will. But after 45 some odd years of administering this program, we were against the inclusion in the beginning in 1966. And the bill jacket we were opposed to be included in this program and financing this program. And shortly thereafter, in 1968, counties began to impose a sales tax. So that's why we have the current sales tax structure in New York State. That's why we have the current property tax structure in New York State at our level, is because of Medicaid and the county local taxation. We're funding almost $1 billion a week in total, state, federal, local, for one program, Medicaid, and it's unsustainable. As you know, and the governor knows, and is trying to redesign this program, it has to be part of this $10 billion some odd structural gap that we have in the 11-12 state budget. But last year, the legislature added language in the budget, which we encouraged a veto on, to create and implement a plan for the state to assume the administrative responsibilities of the medical assistance program performed by county social services districts. In developing such plan, the Commissioner of Health shall work in consultation with each social service district to effectuate this plan. After that law was created in early summer, our organization formed a team, a very diverse team, including representatives of the city and county representatives from all over the state, treasurers, controllers, legislators, county executives, social services commissioners. We studied this issue. We spent 3 months discussing it. We had very little interaction with the state health department, and I believe it's been a failure in effectuating that policy over the last several months, due in large part to the transition of government. But nonetheless, it's been a failure. We do not support this initiative, which is the current law, until there is a clear and defined goal of what the state is trying to accomplish with respect to taking over or assuming the administrative function of Medicaid at the local level. It was ill-defined and remains ill-defined as we go forward. But there were a few guiding policy considerations that came out of this report, which was contentious. There was arguing going on in this room amongst counties. It was drastically diverse from the city to Long Island to upstate about how we administer this program. And there is a lot of local flavor, if you will, about how this is in fact being implemented in each of the individual counties. But some of the guiding policy considerations were that the state should use this as a historic opportunity to begin the full assumption of the Medicaid program costs and the administrative responsibilities by 2014. Notable system-wide savings would not be realized by removing counties from the administrative responsibilities. We were promised $400 million of savings by the legislature when they enacted this proposal last year. We haven't seen a dime of savings, nor do we anticipate savings. Rather, we see in the alternative, it would cost counties money if the state removed the administrative reimbursement.
How would that be?
Capital expenditures, buildings are constructed to deliver Medicaid programs in counties across the state. Health information technology, who's paying for the longevity payments for public workers who are currently county workers, but the law calls for a transition to them to become state officials or state social services workers. We have run an analysis where, in effect, cost counties money on this program. We're currently reimbursed 100% of the cost to administer this program at the county level. We don't see a savings. Rather, we see it as an opportunity to redesign this program consistent with the Medicaid redesign team that the governor has initiated with the work of this body. But in a vacuum, we see it as the wrong way to go, to initially do that. Number two, the state must carefully identify and communicate the benefits and rationale for the state assumption of Medicaid administration and the issues it wishes to solve. We don't know why they did this out of the blue and act this proposal. Third, a state takeover of Medicaid administration should first do no harm, fiscally and programmatically. This has never been clearly communicated to local government officials. Fourth, counties must be consulted regularly in the state assumption of Medicaid administrative functions and costs in order for the state to do no harm, or preferably to improve on how the program is currently administered by counties today. And finally, the state, in conjunction with the county, should swiftly identify the continued role counties should play in facilitating and coordinating health care under the new administrative model as a long-term goal. A couple of observations that we made as part of the Medicaid redesign team, and we are fully engaged with Governor Cuomo in his effort to redesign Medicaid. It's a necessary function, as you know, and this House will be very much engaged in it. In that process, as well as the State Assembly. Categories of saving, as we see it, fall into three buckets: utilization, reimbursement, and eligibility. And in that first bucket, some of the things that we're recommending and our members are suggesting to us is in the area of utilization. This includes the number of services provided. Is there overutilization in a specific category? This may also include the delivery model itself. Does existing policy lead to care being provided in the most efficient setting? Can different delivery models achieve savings and better quality? One of the areas that we're going to be recommending, and as I led off with, is the integrity of the program and enhanced fraud, waste, and abuse activities and tools that counties currently have. The data, as you know, through Salient and some of the other models that we've used to generate reports about anomalies in the system and try to address those systems and put in place a filter before these expenses occur. Medicaid managed care, we've talked a lot. A lot of the panelists have talked about these areas. I think we should talk about why are the elderly and the disabled, older adults, carved out of Medicaid? What was the legislative rationale? Does it make sense? Did it make sense? Does it make sense now? Limit service carve-outs. State should also include more services such as pharmacy supplies under managed care. Things to engage in this process over these next couple of months. Medicaid transportation services, sharing we currently have a demonstration program in the Hudson Valley in Senator Larkin's district where we're running a demonstration pilot program on non-emergency medical transportation services. We think this model has the potential to save tens of millions of dollars across the state, and we should expand that all across the state. Third, under this category of utilization is prescription drugs. We think that we've run an analysis in the counties outside of New York City, and about 80% of the Medicaid expenditure outside of New York City, we've discovered tens of millions of dollars were spent on brand name drugs when a generic equivalent was available. We think we can do a better job of that, of dispensing generics. An examination of a strict formulary structure, like the Veterans Administration. It works for the Veterans Administration. It's been there for a long time that we should discuss and be looking at that area too. Enhanced utilization review and a free market approach to dispensing fees should be examined. I'm sorry that the Lewin Group wasn't here because that group estimates that over a 10-year savings, the state could save $4.4 billion in gross Medicaid funds if some of these proposals were initiated. In the areas of reimbursement, I know I've just got a few minutes left here.
No. I'm doing this because there's a slide from the Lewin Group that I really want.
Yeah, pharmacy from the Lewin Group has pointed out there's a huge savings in pharmacy cost, and we would encourage some of those to be looked into. In the area of utilization, which is the second bucket, if you will, of cost savings or areas where we could save costs. Outside of the few hospitals that we have, the majority of the reimbursement for counties is in the area of nursing homes, county nursing homes, and they've been a problem for a long time with respect to the financing of these homes. We believe they have a place in the system. We believe that place is ill-defined and that there should be a greater niche established for county nursing facilities in conjunction with the private sector and the not-for-profit sector of nursing facilities. What that niche is, we have some ideas, but in the short term, we believe the state should work to ensure the health department certifies a nursing home payment. We believe the reimbursement schedule that's on the books today has been ignored, will be ignored, is not being certified by the federal government. Therefore, we cannot run what's called an intergovernmental transfer, an IGT payment for counties. And we need to have certification by the state on simply what will be the payment to county nursing facilities in 2011. We don't need to have a reimbursement schedule, just what will be the payment so that we could run a calculation, cost the state nothing, but provides an important stability for these safety net providers. Finally, in the area of eligibility, what populations are eligible? Mandatory versus optional. We have 14 mandatory federal Medicaid components and 34 optional programs currently. The state, it's our understanding, incorporates all of these in the benefit design. Savings can be derived from modifying the number of services and or the frequency covered under New York's Medicaid program. These should all be evaluated. In fact, our largest county in western New York, Erie County, has asked for the ability to do an optional services or run an optional program. We don't know what the law, the federal law, would be regarding the statewideness of this program, having the city of New York offer a unique Medicaid program using optional or mandatory services, but looking at the benefit design, we feel should be on the table. Finally, in the area of eligibility, the current scope of the Medicaid program is unsustainable, and a thoughtful review of eligibility levels should be undertaken. Optional populations and income thresholds should be reviewed. It's unclear if short and long-term fiscal goals can be achieved without a comprehensive review of the entire program. Medicaid eligibility changes are currently prohibited by the federal government, but it may begin as of July 1st of 2011 under federal law for current populations served by Medicaid above 133% of the federal poverty level if the state is facing a deficit in the upcoming fiscal year. So we have some ideas. We have other observations that we have with respect to implementing federal health reform at the local level, using some of these demonstration programs to engage counties in the areas of mental health. And some of these areas are high cost. But again, appreciate the opportunity, Senator Hannon, to engage. I concur. I think we've had a policy void over this last couple of years, driven in large part to the budget deficit. But I think we have a unique opportunity here as we implement the new federal law. So, again, thank you very much.
Thank you. Senator Duane has joined us. What I'd like to do is Jeff Smith, the Lewin Group, they had done a study that focused a lot on pharmacy. Caitlin, if you go to the very next slide. And I, just putting it up, nowhere do I have the understanding that Mr. Smith would have. But I thought the numbers of this and three more slides are very important to get a grasp of one other of the major dimensions that we have of the whole healthcare system. And this slide is not just for the spending of the $4.4 billion, but the rate of increase that was incurred in the dual eligible population while there was almost a steadiness in regard to the number of recipients. The savings right there are incredible, 4.4 over 10 years. Let me then go to one of the theses that they have in their paper, which is to try to introduce a greater percentage of our Medicaid population under for pharmacy benefits. And it's kind of difficult to quickly get the points they raised, but simply under a managed care organization, the amount of generic drugs prescribed is far higher than those under a fee-for-service Medicaid dispensing. They also go through dispensing fees, ingredient costs, and then the drug utilization, once again, is higher under Medicaid fee-for-service programs than in Medicaid managed care organizations, suggesting a degree of care management and oversight. We also had carved out in 1998 pharmacy from managed care, Medicaid managed care. Question is, should that be reexamined, and what savings might come about through that? And that would all be up. I'm trying to get my, I think those are the slides that I wanted you to see, and just get a sense of that there are other dimensions. I especially wanted to do it because I was on radio this morning and people said, well, are there chances to make savings? And overall, Mr. Smith, I think his paper says that there is about a chance for $30 billion of savings over a 10-year program. And so even in New York, the chance of a billion or two in the first year might be significant to look at. So,
you know, Senator, along that line, maybe we could take a look at the rebates, how the rebate system works in New York State, and have a better understanding in pharmacy as well.
Well, it's rebates, supplemental rebates. It's it will be a subject of a lively discussion. For the first time that, in my experience, we had Budget Office discuss it as part of the Medicaid redesign team, and a little bit of it is included in the report that they have up on the governor's website, and it's also part of managed health care. Lots of great information. We're obviously so far beyond what we've been able to do in terms of engaging people before, so I thank you. This has been an awesome, enriching discussion. While you're gathering your breath, Senator Seward had a question. No.
I would.
Yes. Senator Seward is also chair of the Insurance Committee, so highly important in the next few months with federal health care reform.
Well, thank you, Senator Hannon. First of all, I'd just like to say that I found all of the presentations very enlightening because we've heard about in previous years, usually at budget time, the need for Medicaid reform. But the definition of that reform generally has been, let's pay the provider less. And that's hardly reform of the system, even though it may, you know, meet a particular budget target. What I liked about what we've heard here today is providing suggestions for the delivery of services in a much more efficient, cost-effective way. And that's exactly where we really need to go. That is true Medicaid reform. So I like this system of that the process we're going through at this particular time. A couple of the presenters, I know, Dan, I'm looking at your my notes from your presentation. You talked about the medical homes program, and you've actually attached some savings over the next 10 years to the expanded use of those, something like in the area of $33 billion, which has got my attention.
We promoted the medical homes. I don't think we.
Okay. Maybe I'm looking at a different document. This is medical homes, as well as the accountable care organizations, the ACOs. Mm-hmm. I know they've been mentioned a couple of times.
I think the number came from Lewin, but yes, we supported both.
Right. Could you? Those are not insignificant savings of what has been cited here, at least the document I'm looking at. Could you expand a little bit about what are the impediments that we would face in terms of going forward with, let's take these two particular initiatives in particular?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the medical home model is real, well, actually in a way both. Maybe I should start with accountable care because the medical home could be part of that. And say, first of all, that no one's quite sure exactly what an accountable care organization is in spite of all of the talk about it. but in general, the attempt to coalesce of an array of providers within the system or in a virtual capacity to deliver the care for a given population for a set amount across their illness or to prevent an illness. So to the extent that it presses, it essentially creates incentives to keep people out of institutions and deliver the least costly, most effective care. It assumes, therefore, as does the medical home, that the bulk of the focus or the concentration for the most emphasis is going to be on prevention and primary care or follow-up care post-hospital. So what we have in upstate New York and the Adirondacks is an interesting attempt to take a medical home concept, which is going to assure or attempts to assure that a patient is going to receive consistent care from a physician or nurse practitioner, physician assistant, but from a consistent set of providers who are going to be able to track that patient's care, get to know that patient, and then link and essentially manage what is required for that patient throughout their episode. Whereas today, especially in Medicaid, this tends to be much more random. The care follow-up is much more random, and usually emergency room-based is people go wherever they wish, whenever they need, frequently to an ER because they don't have a home, if you will, in quotes, but you know, a consistent place to go to have their care coordinated. So like many of the other things we've talked about today, the medical home assumes a coordination capacity, assumes the ability to track the patient and direct the patient, assumes many times that we've been flexible about the workforce limitations, the scope of practices that they need to be worked out, but essentially that, again, a patient is going to get the care they need when they need it at the least intensive site. Now, what they've done in the Adirondacks and we've done in some other experimentation around the states is to say, all right, how do we engage the physician in all of this? Because ultimately, still, the physician is the one who really diagnoses the patient and has the pen that drives the utilization of services. And if they're going to be consistently responsible over time, they need to be part of this medical home model and the specialists that they refer to. And one would seek to connect to it as well over time. So what they've done in the Adirondacks is to say to the physician community up there and to the hospitals up there, we need you to make a commitment to work with each other to improve the quality of care. Because it's not just a matter about showing up at the same place and having the same doctor, it's how we're going to measure the quality. We want to see what is termed clinical integration go on at the same time so that the care that's being provided is being constantly measured, that there's a commitment to engage in evidence-based practices to make sure that the best science is being brought to the particular case at all times, and that in return for independent physicians, specialist hospitals coming together under the supervision of the Department of Health in that case, they are allowed to also negotiate together. So they negotiate their rates for the services provided through that medical home with the insurers who sit at the table openly with them and with the department. In a sense, it becomes therefore a collaboration not just among providers but among insurers. Now, a medical home doesn't have to have that component necessarily attached to it, but it's been a considerable value where you have rural areas and you don't have the concentrated capacity to deal with it if you can't coalesce individuals. In effect, effective PHSPs and managed care plans, you know, could very easily, if they haven't already, Montefiore certainly tries this, as does Strong Memorial in Rochester. But the effort, again, to provide a consistent place where an individual goes to get their care managed through especially through primary care. And then depending on how far you want to go, as you branch out, you could bundle a rate so that it includes that and a hospital. You could create a bigger bundle and include post-hospital care, whether it's nursing home or home health. Or you could say, this is the interesting thing about the federal government's proposals, is that they're not sure either how this is going to evolve. So what they're saying is, look, we've got $10 billion. We're going to distribute the $10 billion as venture capitalists to stimulate initiatives around coordinating care. And if the secretary thinks they work, then she has the ability to roll it out across the country. And we want New York to, you know, get some of this initial dollars. So the other point I would make about this is every opportunity, like the intergovernmental transfer reference before, but every opportunity to draw down money from the Center for Medicare and Medicaid initiatives, any opportunity to get a federal waiver that would help us get the capital to move these system redesigns off the ground, or a state plan amendment, or to draw down 90% for the care, as David mentioned, for dual eligibles that go into these programs. It's not just medical, it's all of healthcare is going to move in this direction. And the provider community, to the point about, you know, are you willing to change or not, the provider community is faced with very tough decisions. You're either going to be a part of creating these new forms, or at least experimenting in these new systems, or if you want to hang out and say, look, let it pass, I'm not going to be an early adapter, I'm going to sit back because it costs too much to invest in the capital and the risk taking. You can do that as long as you're the most efficient provider of the service you decide to retain your concentration in, and your quality is extremely high so that others will want to engage you. Otherwise, if we're correct about all this and these coordinated systems evolve, beginning with medical homes through ACOs and the bundling kind of in between, if you're not that and you're not part of it, then you die. It might take 10 years, but you die, because eventually the system will be built around you. Long-winded answer, sorry.
Okay, well, I appreciate the clarification on those points. But you do, even though you're not ready to attach a number, you do see some savings and efficiencies.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
Senator Duane.
Excuse me, I apologize for my late arrival, but it seems to be a good time for something I was very curious about. Can any of you just tell me about the relationship between PDPs, you know, the preferred drug program, and the drug review program, the clinical drug review program, and the and generally the contracts or the deals that the state makes with pharmaceutical companies. What is the relationship between what happens when someone is in a hospital or a nursing home and they have their own set of preferred drugs, if you will? Do you see what I mean? I can't help but to notice whether in facilities where there's a Medicaid private pay mix, it doesn't really matter. The hospital or the nursing home prescribes, I don't want to say the drugs that they're most comfortable with that do the same thing, but the ones that they may have their own contract with a pharmaceutical company. Which takes precedence? Is it what the patient is eligible for, or the resident of a nursing home is eligible for under Medicaid, or are they transferred and the facilities are automatically reimbursed for the prescription drugs that they are in the habit of using in that hospital or nursing home for whatever reason?
You know, I know accountable care and bundle payments well, and it took me a long time to answer it. But I don't have a clue about that. I don't know.
I don't know.
I wonder if the if there's cost savings there. And I noticed whether it's a family member that's been in a long-term care facility and they change from what they were taking at home to something else, and the nurse practitioner or the geriatric physician will say, well, in this facility we use this, which is the same thing, which it is sort of the same thing. But I'm just wondering if the savings that you could get by using what the state is recommending is compared, is there savings there, or is the administration of that something that just wipes that out?
Well,
I think it could even be in a long-term care program, or you know, someone who's in a anyway. But I'll let the question stay.
Well, I think you're raising a very interesting point, which I, like Dan, don't know the exact answer to. But one of the points that's made on the slide that Senator Hannon was pointing out before is the fact that we do carve out from Medicaid managed care, at least if someone's enrolled in Medicaid managed care, the pharmacy benefit altogether. And so it's pretty unmanaged by anyone, which could get to part of your point, which is, you know, what is it that the patient's supposed to be getting versus what, you know, is available in a particular provider setting. My understanding is that part of the carve-out, I think there were a lot of concerns about plans managing prescription drugs at the time, but part of the point of the carve-out from the state's perspective had been that they couldn't get rebates on drugs that were paid for by plans when the plans were paying for it through the premium that they got. That changed in the Affordable Care Act. They now can get rebates based on drugs that are paid for through a managed care plan. And so one of the ideas has been to allow the pharmacy benefit to be a part of the Medicaid managed care benefit so that there could be some more management of that benefit by the Medicaid managed care plan. So that might get at some of what you're talking about. You know, obviously the Medicaid population has some very specific prescription drug needs, which is part of why is part of the reason for the carve-out in the past. So it would have to be looked at very carefully in terms of rolling it in, but that was one of the things that the Lewin report suggested, was to look at better management of that benefit.
And as I say, I think it would be complicated about which would take precedence and why, and where, if there would be a savings at all based on the administration of it. But I think, you know, if you look at it from anything from geriatric to, you know, behavioral health, you know, someone who needs inpatient treatment, already there's challenges there, of which, you know, medication is an important part of that. And so even there, you know, I talked about nursing homes before, but virtually from, you know, any sort of specific care group, I just wondered if there was a possibility for savings there or not. And I don't expect to, you know.
On the slide you missed before, but I don't control the slides, it was talked about how there's a rate of increase in pharmaceuticals among the dual eligibles, and that's one aspect of it. The other part, directly, I think most healthcare providers have their own determination as to what will be the formulary. Sometimes it's as a basic formulary that's derived if you're, say, a big healthcare system, big hospital system, or sometimes it's based on whatever purchasing group you're a part of, which derives savings to you. The rebates themselves, and what you had referred to, Mr. Quario, has been a very closely held, contested fact here in the state, so much so that, about 4 years ago, one of the vendors came and made a presentation and said, we do rebate management for 49 states. And what we do is make sure that everything you've purchased, we scour, we look at databases, and if there's any chance that there's a rebate available, we get it from the state, and of course we get a commission. So we said, sounds great, go to the Department of Health. They came back 2 months later and they said, Department of Health says no. So that consulted with our counterparts in the assembly, we drew up a piece of legislation, say, go to bid this and come up with this system. Passed both houses unanimously. The governor vetoed it, said it would cost money. So that was a very big part of the frustration of going through this. The irony of the footnote is, about a month ago, the representative of that company came and said, guess what, the Department of Health has just called us. So we go through lots of iterations in regard to pharmaceuticals, but frankly, the conclusion of the Lewin Group is a surprise that for all of what we're supposed to have been driving for savings, there still is seemingly a large measure, and it's not so much at the beating up on the pharmaceutical companies, which tends to be a popular pastime among legislators at times. Questions? Sarah Martin?
Well, Dan, as usual, it was a great day. It was great. Rich, the second time I heard you was good. Stephen, you do a tremendous job for the counties.
Thank you.
But we're going through a session now with the second floor where your input is going to be very, very important. Whether we survive or not, a lot of it will depend on the cuts in health. But as Senator Hannon said just a few minutes ago, just now, about the pharmaceuticals. I have served on health committees for over 20 years, and it seems like they're the whipping boy. But when they come up with something that says, this will enable us to give you the required prescriptions and do a reduction, they all say AWP and all of that. They're missing something. And I'm wondering if you're going to be able to insert your strong feelings on this. Because in the end, his group is going to hurt the worse than hospitals. The counties are screaming about it. For the last 10 days, after Senator Hannon told me about this meeting, I went to hospitals, I went to pharmacies, I went to the warehouses, I went to the freestanding clinics, and they're saying, you have to do something. We're providing medication for them, and we could do it and buy it in another asset. We can't get any help. I called the Department of Health. I didn't know that Senator did. And they told me, wait until after the budget. You four people have a free ride to do something to make it happen. If you don't, then all of the talk about we're going to change, will be the same thing, Dan, when we come back up to April or May or June or July or August. I think it's very important. You know, David, when you come out with some specifics that bite at your apple, I like some of them. I've taken more notes here than most times I do. But I want to go back and tell my doctors, my hospitals, my two counties, and my independent care systems, what you're saying. And they're going to be looking at what you actually produce for this, because the governor said you're operating independently. You're going to have all of these meetings. I'll be looking, because so will everybody else in the state. Thank you very much.
Yes, Senator, totally agree with you about the importance of pharmaceuticals. I mean, one of the most important primary care services is prescribing drugs that can help people stay healthy and out of the hospital. One of the major strategies for reducing hospital readmissions is to try and make sure that after someone leaves the hospital, they actually are able to comply with the prescription drug regimen that was prescribed for them so that they don't end up back in the hospital, they remain healthy. I think the issue is, and again, I think it's the same with pharmaceutical issues in the state where we've done, as you mentioned, you know, AWP minus blah, blah in the past. The question is, can we make sure the proper utilization of prescription drugs? Can we make sure that people are getting the right drugs, not getting duplicative drugs, not getting ones that actually serve cross purposes, so that someone really is helping the patient and helping the Medicaid beneficiary monitor what drugs that have been prescribed at which times and make sure that they're doing the right thing by them, as well as using generics where possible and doing some of the other things. possible. So it's more of a utilization issue and proper utilization issue, I think, than beating up on the pharmaceutical companies and saying, let's lower their prices more.
Thank you, David.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. You guys were really kind to OMEG today. I really thought that was pretty good. The New York City, obviously, is the Medicaid capital of the world, and I guess Brooklyn is the Medicaid fraud capital of the nation. Having said that, we've seen what's happened in the city over time. Closing of St. Vincent, closing of a number of hospitals, the downsizing, downstate taking over Litch, a whole host of things going on. And it's a very vulnerable system. And you spoke of us not having the ability to look forward. And I think we've had good discussions with the chairman here of this committee. And I want to thank the chairman and the senators here. And I want to thank all the individual presenters, because of the intellect and the knowledge that's in this room is equal to none. But we have a bill there that's going to be more detailed about the regular Medicaid expenditures reporting. And it's a 5-year review of the Medicaid procedure, and it's a 3-year projection. And this would give us an opportunity to understand what's and where and how we're going forward. We've also talked about a 2-year budget bill, which we've talked about year after year, but we've never seemed to be able to get there. And I think that's because the system is so vulnerable. I believe maybe this is the year that we discuss that. Maybe this is the year that we go forward and we really get some changes done. We've talked about the one-stop shop and the point of entry and the managed care until it was blue in the face. We've made some changes, and we know the individual silos. When you hit this silo, what it does to that silo, and when you touch that silo, what it does to the other silo, and then everybody comes in and, you know, has their say. I believe you all had very compelling reports and compelling savings in each of your statements here today. Some of the statements, obviously the accounting goes over a 10-year period. Maybe if the three of you could, or four of you could give us, and give it to the chair, the a breakdown of, say, this year over the next 2 years, 3-year total, of what type of savings you can see in the system if silos stay the same. And if you see a change, and what change you see, that would give us increased savings over the next 3 years, obviously looking at this year being the year to implement, if the chair could get that and that could be given to us, we would greatly appreciate it. I think, again, you've done an outstanding job, a lot of work to be done here, and we can't catch quilted any longer. It has to be corrected, and thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Especially thank you because Senator Golden, chair of the Aging Committee, ranges throughout all of the same healthcare providers as we do, plus a few more, especially when it comes to the services the counties provide. Lots of different comments, but first of all, Mr. Aquario, I thought that the Medicaid takeover bill was your bill. Now, let me set the stage for this.
Lots of people do.
Let me set the stage for this. We never did a budget last year.
Right.
And even though my colleague, Senator Duane, was chair, he never did a budget. We had a health, what was the equivalent of, or supposed to be the equivalent of, a health budget in an emergency spending bill, for which there was no debate, no discussion, no hearings, no memos, and that's why I presume that was the takeover was your bill as a first step to perhaps getting greater fiscal relief in regard to Medicaid. So I find this most instructive, points well made, and obviously that cap that we enacted about 4 years ago, while it may have saved the counties several billions of dollars, that's an expenditure on the state side, and one of the reasons Medicaid expenditures in the state have gone up. Anyway, that's a long introduction to. I'm most curious about different projects. Dan, you had mentioned we have a little bit of different things. You talked about a demo project for the non-emergency transportation service. We're going to be faced with such pressure for deliverables in 6 weeks, April 1. I'm wondering to what extent we have actual demos that have saved money, are up and running, can be scaled up, or if not scaled up to a greater number, can be adopted in other parts. Certainly, the medical home that is in Chemung County came about for one stark reason. They don't have Medicaid managed care there. And the county executive made a convincing argument that there was no management given to the entire group of Medicaid fee-for-service recipients. And yet we still have, if I name my numbers are correct, about 16 or 17 other counties in the state that don't have Medicaid managed care because they have too sparse a population. But to the extent we could take what's happened in Chemung, and I don't think it happened overnight. I think
it's a painful
2-year, 3-year process.
Yes.
I think we even did demonstration projects.
It was painful.
We made Winter explain what the heck the yes. project was. So, but to the extent that it can be in other places, and to the demo project there, Rick, you have gone through an incredible amount of long-term care projects. We have more little long-term care projects in this state than any place else in the nation. The one, the managed long-term care project, is great attributes. You can write it up, and after 10 years, it still has 8,000 recipients. I mean, and how many, I don't know how many long-term care people are in need of long-term care, home care in this state, but my guess is it's probably 20 times that. So to the extent we can do this, I don't know if you can, at short run, you can adopt a new managed care, intensive care coordination group, mm-hmm. called it. But yet there are other things that might well be adopted if we can do this. I'm just not sure what's there ripe.
We should do everything we possibly can, but I just want to set expectations a little lower than where Senator Larkin and you were hoping, because for many of these things, the data just doesn't exist yet. I mean, in some cases, the systems don't exist yet. The department is studying these high-cost populations, and like we have with a DRG, you know, all of the care is sort of wrapped in the DRG. They've talked about creating something, I think they call it clinical risk groups for these high-cost Medicaid patients who need the coordinated care. The data for that is at DOH. Now, that's the kind of data that Haney's or Greater New York or NIASA or whomever would need in order to be doing some analysis. In most cases, the ideas that have come out now are not new ideas. Most of us have, you know, ravaged through the myriad reports that have come out, including Medicaid task forces of the legislature going back 10 years, to try and cull out what are the best ideas that, you know, got passed and not implemented or never passed or proposed. And now I've tried to align it with what I said the federal government was doing. If, and I would assume in many cases, the division of the budget costed those concepts out about pharmacy changes or spend downs with the elderly population or managed care savings that could have been expanded or, you know. I don't know what they've learned from the medical home models that we have, the half dozen or so, but frankly, the Department of Health, I think, and or the Division of the Budget probably is going to make the final determination anyway, right? So if I say something's worth $500 million and it's going to be somewhat speculative, and they say, okay, we believe it's $200 million, but Sisto said five, we'll hold them to five, and if he doesn't hit five, then we'll knock $300 million that he didn't get, right? An across-the-board cut. Or, that might be worth five, but it might be worth two. So let's call it two, and then we can still cut them in order to get to the target we want, right? So we're at grave risk for being speculative, for shooting too high, for shooting too low, at a time when I know that most of what we talked about hasn't been implemented in enough places in the country to be credible in terms of, or verifiable in terms of backing it up. I love the fact that Lewin has these numbers.
And so did Greater New York, staff people who were expert aides to them. But I think a lot of these numbers are very high. So the reality is that it is taking 3-4 decades in some cases for the system to evolve the way it has. It's going to take 6 or 7 years to get dramatic transformation. I think there are a lot of ideas that were put on the table today and at the Medicaid reform meeting and all of the different reports that can yield considerable savings. But I also believe that the administration probably can put a number on them much more accurately than I can.
Well, you point out one of the bigger problems, which is how we score things. As you go through, we've all seen it from somebody who's running an institution and they come to the legislature and they say, this can actually save $1 million a year. And then you go to a budget negotiation and budget goes, it's a great idea, it'll save 100,000.
Right.
And you're just gnawing your teeth. And then you turn around, you would actually adopt it, you didn't get it scored the way you wanted, and in the next year's budget, they score it as $1 million a year.
Right.
So the credibility in order to get through a difficult time like now, needs to be there. Because the other credibility they have is either going to be there or not, and that is whether their revenue estimates are correct. Actually, the interesting part is the last couple of years, the legislature, under different hats, and the Division of Budget have been very close in revenue estimates. It usually is, I guess, times of growth. So.
I think Dan is right that it does take 5 or 6 years to get full-blown effect of this, but if it's from 5 or 6 years from the day that you start restructuring,
right.
So that that has to begin to happen mm-hmm. now. And I also think that you're right that no one knows. There's nothing that's purely tested in a random control study or anything like that, equivalent of a clinical trial, about what's going to work. I think what we have to do is focus on what aligns with federal health reform, as a couple of us have said, and figure out, like, the health homes, I think, is a really major addition to both primary care and to long-term care. And there's every reason to think that it could be effective, but there's experience in North Carolina and Vermont of a similar kind of program. I think that's the best that we're going to get in terms of verification. But I really do think restructuring so that we can position ourselves to do right. these kind of things and make real progress. And then, unfortunately, this is where I ended up saying that we're going to have to change some things like eligibility for nursing home eligible care, level of care, because it's the only way we're going to get something in the immediately. And that is better to me than taking across-the-board cuts, because across-the-board cuts to me that fairly fragile financial organizations and honestly, including my own, a couple of years of across-the-board cuts, and we're out of. There are lots of us that are out of business.
Yes, Senator Hannon, you mentioned the question about whether there are demos, and there certainly are that are going on in New York now. I know Health and Hospitals Corporation, Montefiore, as Dan mentioned before, New York Presbyterian has had a lot of its clinics certified under federal accreditation agencies as medical homes. One of the challenges, though, has been reimbursement. Because if this is all done right, you will, of necessity, reduce hospital admissions. And so you are, you know, doing the right thing and investing in these health homes will also, you know, cause that same provider to have lost money, and rightly so, over time. But to have some reimbursement, which is now available with this 90% match under the ACA for sort of the monthly cost of coordinating the care with these care coordination teams that Haney's and we have been talking to the health department about, is really important, because that will help provide the investment to go forward and actually better coordinate the care, reduce hospitalizations, and make people more well over time. But we can definitely bring forward to you jointly and bring in the people who have done this and who have done these demos within the different providers within the state, so that you can have a better sense of exactly what it is that HHC and others have been doing.
Points made, well made. And by the way, in nursing homes, there are not payments for 2009 yet. So there's before we even talk about current year and adjustment and all that, there's a lot of catching up. Or if the cash isn't there, then there needs to be realistic policy making, because patients need to be taken care of. Senator Dwyer.
I also believe that what has most recently happened with just across the board cuts with DRPs and continuing resolutions is just terrible, horrible public policy. And with the new group which the governor has put Senator Hannon and I on, why did we say yes? We should run for the hills. But we're charged with coming up with something by March 1st. And I do, you know, if we don't have a budget by April 1st, there's a terrible precedent now of just across the board cuts. Mm-hmm. So we are charged with a, as you know, a very rapid time frame. And he's given us the luxury of, you know, looking at things more long term. So, but I am concerned that, you know, I don't want to be stuck in the same place of just across, it's just horrible public policy, of which our ability to make positive changes even during difficult times is completely removed, as is yours. So I was kind of intrigued with the CMO idea, which Rick, you wrote about. The problem is also that's, I think you said it's a 5-year, you know, implementation, and I have concerns about the Department of Health, which, you know, has lost a lot of staff and due to budget cuts, and so implementation of things already are, you know, highly problematic within that agency. I mean, we had a thing about medical homes, it was very interesting, but there hasn't been a rapid expansion. We tried to fund more, you know, doctors across New York, because people, they weren't getting paid, and now they are. And these are all little steps, but even the assessment tool for personal care and long-term care, you know, as I understand it, there has been a group that's, you know, trying to be contracted to actually have an assessment that we could look at, but now it's sitting in the controller's office. No blame to him. I mean, I don't know how long he's had it to look at, but all of these things seem to take a much longer time, and you know, I think somehow we're going to have to work together to speed these things up, because great ideas that linger and then become, as Senator Hannon said, they become the executive's next year's, you know, ideas, which they say they'll implement, and then it sits there as well. So, you know, we're going to be spending a lot of time working together on this, but I do think the thing that we have to keep ahead of is that we just don't do more across-the-board cuts across the entire spectrum, because that's just going to create, you know, pain that's unhelpful in, you know, sometimes I guess pain, like a hip replacement, the first few days you're like, oh, why did I do it? Then now I know why I did it. But this is pain that's just pain across the board. There is no good part of it. So I feel a huge urgency to get ahead of what we've been charged to do here.
And Senator, in that spirit, I think that an investment in health department staff that was tracking, that was responsible for expediting the demonstrations and any transition to new structures like the care management organization, if that doesn't happen, they will die, because there's not enough people to both maintain what's going on and start new things. They're not there.
I'd like to echo, Senator, that comment from the county perspective. We see the health department understaffed, underprepared for what lies ahead. And the implementation of many of these programs we're talking about, we believe the agency needs resources and staff.
No argument here.
Well, it's going to be very difficult. They've lost hundreds of people, including, from my standpoint, a lot of people in the counselor's office. So there's going to be a great deal of difficulty in moving that forward. My other colleagues left. We have a conference, but I think this has been enormously successful, and from my standpoint, and hopefully also for the members of the committee, didn't once ask anybody for what an acronym meant, looked at all my colleagues' faces, and they knew. So it's you're finding a body that's becoming a lot more familiar, and so the more we can talk about and common goals, I think we'll get some semblance of rationality out of this process this year.
All new acronyms coming.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.